Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. The DGP of J&K police has stated that around 60 foreign militants have infiltrated into Jammu and Kashmir with the objective of carrying out spectacular terror attacks before Prime Minister Modi addresses the UN General Assembly on the 27th of September. So this is clearly an attempt by Pakistan to bring international attention to Kashmir following the revocation of special status of J&K under Article 370. According to intelligence reports, local recruitment for terror groups has gone down in the recent past, and hence Pakistan is trying to compensate by pushing across foreign militants into the Indian side of the border. This type of terrorism is referred to as cross-border terrorism and state-sponsored terrorism. See, cross-border terrorism is nothing but the export of terrorism from one country to another across their borders. And state-sponsored terrorism is the involvement of state agencies in sponsoring non-state actors such as terror groups in order to wage a covert proxy war against a target country. In the case of Pakistan, India suffers from both cross-border terrorism and as well as state-sponsored terrorism. We have the state agencies of Pakistan, such as the ISI and its army, which provide complete support to terror outfits that are operating against India. Pakistan has not only sheltered anti-India terror outfits, such as the Lashkar-e-Toyba, the Jaish-e-Mohammed, Huji, Harkatul Mujahideen, etc., but it has also enabled these groups to cross over into India across the LOC and carry out attacks in the Kashmir Valley. You can see in this map the locations of various terror training camps that have been set up by Pakistan. These outfits operate in close coordination with the Pakistani state agencies, and they make use of the state support to promote radicalization, to carry out recruitment, to provide training, to acquire weapons, and even to infiltrate across the border into India. Most of these terror training camps are located in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and as well as deep inside Pakistan, especially in its Punjab province and the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province, which was formerly referred to as the Northwest Frontier Province. This is where most of the anti-India groups operate, and they would have established terror launch pads just across the LOC in order to infiltrate trained militants into India. At these launch pads located along the line of control, they are supported in their infiltration attempts by the Pakistani army and its border guarding force, the Pakistan Rangers. These Pakistani forces deliberately violate the ceasefire and they open indiscriminate firing against the positions of the Indian Army and the BSF in order to provide cover to the foreign militants who are attempting to infiltrate into India by crossing over the border. Since many decades, India has been at the receiving end of this type of cross-border terrorism and state-sponsored terrorism that emanates from Pakistan. It is not just India which has been affected. Even neighboring Afghanistan has experienced the same. You can see the terror camps of the Taliban and the Al-Qaeda that are located over here along the Af-Pak border. They are mainly concentrated in Waziristan and the federally administered tribal areas, which have now become a part of the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province. This is where notorious outfits affiliated to the Taliban, such as the Haqqani network, have found a safe haven. And the Haqqani network has not only targeted the Afghan government and the Western forces, but it has also carried out major attacks against the Indian embassy and consulates in Afghanistan and Indian investments in Afghanistan. Then next to the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province, we have Balochistan, and in the city of Quetta, Pakistan has sheltered the Quetta Shura, which is a militant outfit comprising of the top leaders of Taliban. These Taliban leaders belonging to the Quetta Shura were given a safe haven by Pakistan after the US-led coalition forces toppled the Taliban government in 2001 following the 9/11 attacks. So this is how Pakistan has nurtured a variety of terror groups against India, and since the 1980s, it has actively sponsored cross-border terrorism and as well as state-sponsored terrorism against both the countries. That's the reason why India has even labeled the country as an exporter of terrorism. Next, on page number one, the Hindu carries an image which depicts thousands of volunteers taking part in a cleanliness drive at the Puri beach in Odisha as a part of the International Coastal Cleanup Day celebrations. Next, in a related article on page number 7, it has been reported that thousands of volunteers across India have taken part in a community-driven cleanliness drive to clean up the beaches and the coastal areas on the occasion of International Coastal Cleanup Day. The volunteers have not only taken part in a cleanliness drive, but they have also advocated the scientific management of the waste that has been collected by promoting the concept of 3R, which stands for Reduce, Reuse and Recycle. So in this context, let us talk about the International Coastal Cleanup Day, which is celebrated on the 21st of September every year. See, this is a community-driven environmental initiative that began in the United States around 30 years ago. Under this initiative, coastal communities are encouraged to work along with volunteers and environmental groups and take up the social work of cleaning the beaches and the coastal areas. This initiative was started by two environmental activists who were working for an environmental NGO known as Ocean Conservancy. This cleanup initiative was started in 1986 by Linda Marinus, who was inspired by the work of her colleague Katie O'Hara. These two environmental activists were working with Ocean Conservancy in order to understand the role of plastics in polluting our marine environment. And they began the cleanup initiative in order to deal with the massive amounts of waste that was being littered around beaches and coastal areas. So they both worked together and motivated the local communities to participate in a coastal cleanup initiative. And they not only collected the waste, but they also started scientifically managing this waste. The waste that was collected under the cleanup initiative was scientifically recorded and documented, and it was also processed accordingly in order to promote the concept of reduce, reuse and recycle. Since then, the movement has spread in its popularity across the United States, and it has also spread across 100 countries. And on the 21st of September every year, volunteers and local communities across the world, they come together to mark the International Coastal Cleanup Day. Next, let us talk about Ocean Conservancy. Ocean Conservancy is a non-governmental, not-for-profit environmental advocacy group that was founded in 1972 and it is headquartered in Washington, D.C., United States. In its advisory capacity, the NGO provides policy advice to the U.S. government and the state governments in the United States. And it also conducts research in order to identify the threats to our marine environment. And it also takes up conservation efforts in order to protect our oceanic ecosystems and marine life from the impact of human development. Over the years, Ocean Conservancy has played a key role in protecting marine habitats, in restoring sustainable fisheries, in reducing the human impact on oceanic ecosystems, and in managing oceanic resources. It was because of the efforts of Ocean Conservancy that commercial whaling was banned by the International Whaling Commission in 1982. It was because of the efforts of this organization that the usage of turtle excluder devices was made mandatory in fishing nets in order to protect the sea turtles from getting caught in fishing nets. And the environmental NGO has also been playing a key role in mitigating the impact of climate change on our coral reef ecosystems. Now let's take up the next article. The National Green Tribunal has directed the Central Pollution Control Board to regulate the import of waste tyres in order to ensure that India doesn't turn into a dumping ground for hazardous waste such as waste tyres which are used in the pyrolysis industry. See, with regard to waste management, there is a global trend wherein developed countries dump their hazardous waste on developing countries in order to ensure that their environments are not polluted by the hazardous waste. For example, hazardous waste such as electronic waste or toxic chemicals, they are dumped by the developed countries on developing countries. And this has basically turned the developing countries into a dump yard for hazardous waste materials. So in order to deal with this threat, developing countries such as India provide for very strict regulation and they have even banned the import of hazardous waste from the developed countries. For example, India's Ministry of Environment and Forest has already come out with a set of regulations in order to restrict and regulate the import of hazardous waste and electronic waste. But despite having such strict regulations in place, the import of waste tyres has continued and it has turned India into a dump yard for waste tyres. These imported old tyres are considered to be a hazardous waste because they are processed in the pyrolysis industry, which releases a number of toxic gases into the environment that will not only pollute the environment, but it can also pose a major threat to the health of the workers. See, during the process of pyrolysis, a waste material is thermally decomposed by exposing it to high temperatures in an inert atmosphere. During this process of thermal decomposition, a number of toxic gases are released into the environment, which can threaten not only the environment, but also the health of the workers. During this process of decomposition, the waste material is broken down into smaller molecules, and it is basically turned into carbon. This final output can also be used as a low carbon fuel. So there are strict regulations in place in order to regulate and restrict the import of waste tyres. But despite this, India has turned into a dumpyard of waste tyres, mainly because of non-compliance from the pyrolysis industry. So that's the reason why the National Green Tribunal has directed the Central Pollution Control Board to strictly enforce these regulations on the pyrolysis industry and ensure that India does not turn into a dump yard for waste tyres. Next, on page number 1 and 11, we have an article which is related to the upcoming visit of Bangladesh Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina to India. According to this article, the Chief Minister of West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee, is unlikely to take part in the bilateral negotiations between India and Bangladesh when Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina visits India in the first week of October. The refusal of the Chief Minister to take part in the bilateral negotiations highlights a long-standing dispute between India and Bangladesh, which is the Teesta River dispute. See, the Teesta River is one of the major transboundary rivers between India and Bangladesh, and it originates in the state of Sikkim. From Sikkim, the river flows through West Bengal and it crosses over the border and it enters into Bangladesh. As the Teesta River flows through Bangladesh, it joins with the Brahmaputra River, which is known as the Jamuna in Bangladesh, before it drains into the Bay of Bengal. So this transboundary river has been a source of dispute between India and Bangladesh since the 1970s. See, when Bangladesh was liberated from Pakistan with India's assistance and when it became independent in 1971, both India and Bangladesh shared a very cordial relationship. So as a result, The India-Bangladesh Treaty of Friendship was signed, and under the treaty, a joint river commission was set up in 1972 to resolve all the river disputes. But within a few years, the pro-India government in Bangladesh was overthrown and it was replaced by a pro-Pakistan government. This phase lasted between 1970s and 2009, and during this period, Bangladesh was ruled by the military and as well as by the Bangladesh Nationalist Party, both of which were extremely hostile towards India. So as a result, relations between India and Bangladesh started to deteriorate, and the pro-Pakistan government in Bangladesh started harboring a number of anti-India elements. During this period, Bangladesh had turned into a safe haven for a number of Northeast insurgent groups, and it had emerged as a major security threat for India. So due to this hostility between the two countries, the river dispute was never settled completely to the satisfaction of both the sides. In 1983, a water sharing agreement was signed over the Teesta River, but it was only ad hoc in nature and it provided a higher allocation for India, which caused dissatisfaction in Bangladesh. Then in 1984, the treaty was again revised and it provided for a higher allocation for both the countries. But Bangladesh was still dissatisfied because its demands were not being met by India. And India was unwilling to extend a hand of friendship during this period because Bangladesh had turned into a safe haven for a number of anti-India insurgent groups. But the year 2009 became a major turning point for both the sides because the pro-India Awami League was elected to power and Sheikh Hasina was elected as the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. Under her leadership, a pro-India government took root in Bangladesh and she played a critical role in flushing out the Northeast insurgent outfits which had found a safe haven in Bangladesh. It was because of the assistance offered by Sheikh Hasina that India was able to neutralize major insurgent outfits such as the ULFA and the NSCN. So in return for this assistance, Bangladesh expected that India would fulfill its commitments on the land boundary agreement and the Teesta River dispute. The then UPA government as well was very eager to express its gratitude to Bangladesh by fulfilling its commitments on the land boundary agreement and the Teesta River dispute. So India had decided to favor Bangladesh on the issue of exchange of enclaves and the sharing of Teesta River in order to cut down the influence of China and Pakistan on Bangladesh. So fulfilling these commitments had become a core objective for India's foreign policy in order to build close and strategic relations with Bangladesh. But this national interest of India was derailed due to the impact of coalition politics. The then UPA government did not enjoy majority in the parliament, and as a result, the land boundary agreement was derailed by the opposition parties because for the exchange of enclaves to take place, a constitutional amendment was needed. Then the UPA government could not fulfill its commitments to the Sheikh Hasina government and it failed to ratify the Teesta water sharing agreement due to the opposition expressed by the government in West Bengal. This was again an outcome of coalition politics because the Trinamool Congress, which was in power in West Bengal, was a very important ally of the UPA government in the center. Since water is a very emotive issue and since it is a state subject, regional political interests took over India's national interests and as a result, the UPA government was held hostage by the Trinamool Congress and India could not go ahead and signed the Teesta water sharing agreement with Bangladesh. So in a way, coalition politics and regional politics had left an impact on India's foreign policy. Bangladesh was unhappy that India could not fulfill its commitments even after receiving assistance in wiping out Northeast insurgency inside Bangladesh. So as a result, relations between the two countries were affected, and it was only in 2014, when the Modi government was elected with a complete majority into the parliament, that the land boundary agreement was passed, and India managed to fulfill at least one of its commitments to the Sheikh Hasina government. The land boundary agreement provided for the exchange of enclaves through the 100th Constitutional Amendment Act, and this has resolved the enclave issue between the two sides. But the Modi government has not been able to fulfill India's commitments with regard to the Teesta Water Dispute because of the continued objections from West Bengal. Even though the Modi government is willing to go ahead with the proposal of the UPA government, it has still not managed to overcome the objections of the government of West Bengal. And this is a case of regional politics holding India's foreign policy hostage. So that's the reason why the upcoming visit of Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina is extremely important, because Bangladesh is expecting that India will fulfill its commitments under the Teesta River dispute. But according to reports, the Chief Minister of West Bengal is likely to skip the bilateral talks, and this indicates the continued opposition of the state government to the Teesta water sharing agreement that has been proposed by the centre. Now let's take up a column from page number 16, which illustrates the opportunities that are available to India and China to embrace each other in the emerging domains of digital technology. The article talks about as to how China has already taken a huge lead over other countries in the emerging domains of technology such as 5G, artificial intelligence, big data, smart cities, driverless cars, drones, e-commerce, etc. And not to be left behind, India has also been making considerable progress in these domains of technology, and this presents an ideal opportunity for the two countries to collaborate with each other. In a future world that will be driven by data, India and China will be the largest owners of this precious resource owing to their huge population. So on one hand, both the countries will emerge as the largest data producers in the future. And on the other hand, both the countries are making considerable progress in the emerging domains of technology. So a country which will be able to combine these two will naturally gain tremendous economic advantage and geopolitical advantage. So that is the reason why the United States is opposed to the entry of Chinese companies into the 5G domain. This is also one of the reasons behind the ongoing trade wars between the two global powers. The United States is looking to cripple the Chinese companies that are working in these domains by imposing higher tariffs on them. It is also setting up geopolitical roadblocks for China in order to prevent China from occupying the leadership position in these technology domains. So the writer says that these developments provide the right opportunity for India and China to collaborate with each other and make the best out of this opportunity. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following countries are members to the Arctic Council? Amongst the given options, it is only Finland which is a member of the Arctic Council. So option A is the correct answer. Whereas India and China, they enjoy observer status to the Arctic Council. This question has been asked because we have an article on page number 11 which reports the visit of India's Foreign Secretary Mr. Jaishankar to Finland in order to discuss the issues of terrorism and Kashmir. So India's relations with Finland is extremely important because Finland is one of the members of the Arctic Council and India is one of the non-Arctic observer states to the Arctic Council. So in this context, please note down the membership of the Arctic Council. There are 8 Arctic states. We have Canada, Denmark, which represents Greenland and the Faroe Islands. Then we have Finland, Iceland, Norway, Russia, Sweden, and the United States. These are the 8 member states of the Arctic Council. Please take up an exercise and identify all the non-Arctic observer states to the Arctic Council. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following animal is referred to as the chinkara? The correct answer is option B, the Indian gazelle. Whereas the Indian antelope is referred to as the black buck and the Kashmir red stag is referred to as the hangal. So option B is the right answer. Now let's take up the third question. The popular BCG vaccine is used against which disease? The correct answer is option D, tuberculosis. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following country is located the closest to the Solomon Islands? Amongst the given list of countries, the correct answer would be option A, Australia. Please look at the map. This is where the Solomon Islands are located in the Pacific Ocean. It is located between the equator and the Tropic of Capricorn. And the closest countries are Australia, New Zealand, Indonesia, Papua New Guinea, etc. So amongst the given list of options, Australia is the closest. Hence option A is the correct answer. This question has been asked because it has been reported that China has established diplomatic relations with the Solomon Islands. This is a very important development because until recently, Solomon Islands was supporting the independence claims of Taiwan from China. But with the establishment of diplomatic relations, Solomon Islands has clearly recognized the One China policy and it has said that Taiwan is an integral part of China. This development also shows the increasing influence of China in the Indo-Pacific region. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. The Global Infrastructure Facility is a World Bank collaboration that facilitates the preparation and structuring of complex infrastructure public-private partnership projects in order to enable the mobilization of private sector and institutional investor capital. Option B is the right answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, explain how India is affected by cross-border terrorism and state-sponsored terrorism that emanates from Pakistan. The second question, describe the course of the Teesta River and evaluate the current status of the river dispute between India and Bangladesh. So please write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. And if you like our initiative, please like, comment and share the videos with your fellow aspirants. And please do not forget to hit the subscribe button. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.